President Marcos leads the launching of the so-called green lanes for strategic investments in a bid to attract more foreign businesses into the country. Our very own Pia Gutierrez now joins us with an update. Pia, over to you.
Yes, Carmina, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Thursday morning led the launch of the Green Lanes for Strategic Investments, which is seen to enhance the ease of doing business in the country and make the Philippines more competitive in attracting foreign direct investments. This comes months after President Marcos Jr. signed last February Executive Order No. 18, which ordered the creation of green lanes in government offices that will be in charge of expediting and streamlining the processes and requirements for the issuance of needed permits, licenses, certifications, or authorizations for all projects qualified as strategic investments. This is expected to significantly cut down the processing time for documents needed to start a business in the country. The EO also mandated the establishment of a one-stop action center that shall serve as the single point of entry of these investments. In his speech, the President welcomed this development as he highlighted the need for the Philippines to compete with Asian neighbors and the rest of the world in terms of ease of doing business, which he says many foreign investors that he spoke to during his trips have identified as an area where the country needs to significantly improve. Marcos Jr. explained that compared to the country's direct competitors such as Vietnam, Thailand, or Indonesia, the processing of permits to do business here in the Philippines takes significantly longer because of the many procedures and bureaucratic layers in place. He says that there are some permits here that usually take 36 months to complete, which in other countries will only take as little as 2 weeks to get. He says that the establishment of green lanes is part of continuing government efforts to dismantle the obstacles faced by these investors whenever they decide to do business here in the country.
Executive Order No. 18 signifies the unwavering commitment of this government to simplify procedures and trim bureaucratic layers to ensure the ease of doing business in our country. We gave this a particular priority because we, upon listening to our prospective investors, this was one of the areas where they felt we could do better. I'm confident that the green lanes will pave the way for the realization of many pledges that we have had, including those that I have personally received whilst abroad, ensuring that they will bear fruit for our people and our nation.
Meanwhile, Carmina, DTI Secretary Alfredo Pascual announced that renewable energy firm SunAsia is the first company to receive a certificate of endorsement for these green lanes. The company plans to set up floating solar panels on Laguna Lake that is expected to produce 1.3 gigawatts of power.
President Marcos also witnessed the ceremonial signing of three more contract packages under the North-South Commuter Railway, which is estimated to be worth more than 50 billion pesos in total. Our correspondent John Manaha now joins us with details. John, over to you.
Carmina, good afternoon. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. described the ceremonial signing of these three contract packages under the North-South Commuter Railway as important, as this demonstrates the government's commitment to provide a more efficient and an inclusive transport system to all Filipinos. The nearly 15-kilometer at-grade railways and viaduct structures will rise in Blumentritt, Buendia, EDSA, Senit, Bikutan, and Sukat, and some of these stations would be linked within the Metro Manila subway station in line with the government's goal of transport interconnectivity, and that's according to Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista. Bautista signed the contract packages on behalf of the government, which the president said could generate around 3,000 jobs once civil works begin. For his part, Marcos said the government is conscious of the plight of informal settlers who may be affected by the project and the potential disturbances the North-South Commuter Railway construction may cause. This is why Marcos urged relevant agencies and offices to solve problems related to the right-of-way, which includes the need for land acquisition and the relocation of utility posts in the area so that the affected properties are cleared in time for the commencement of civil works. Let us hear what the president said in his speech.
It was only last April when we gathered for the signing of two other contract packages for the South Commuter Railway project of the North-South Commuter Railway System. Now, As we hold the signing of contract packages SO1, SO3A, and SO3C, we continue to show the commitment to realizing the dream of a more efficient and inclusive public transportation system that every Filipino deserves. With the signing of these three contract packages that cover a total of around 14.9 kilometers of at-grade and railway viaduct structures, we will be a step closer to our goal of serving around 800,000 commuters daily by 2029. While that is the case, we must also recognize the plight of informal settler families who will be affected by the project. These are the inevitable consequences of those that we of this large project. But it is something that we have to go through if we are going to complete the projects as they have been designed, and we will to be able to reap the benefits in the longer term.
Carmina, according to the Department of Transportation, civil works for contract package S01 may begin by the last quarter of this year, while contract package S03A and S03 may begin by the first quarter of next year. Government targets the whole 147-kilometer north-south commuter railway to be operational by 2029 and will cut travel time from Calamba, Laguna to Clark in Pampanga to around 2 hours. Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Job Manahan, there joining us live. The senator also calling on President Marcos to focus on more pressing issues during his State of the Nation address later this month. Among them, the recurring water shortage and the El Nino phenomenon. As for matters that should not be prioritized, Pimentel says the Maharlika Investment Fund is on top of that list.
I hope by that time of the SONA, the Maharlika Investment Fund bill has not yet been signed, so that he will not announce it. So I hope that the announcement is I'm returning this to Congress or I am vetoing it to give the people, not only the members of Congress, but the people more time to study and understand it. Let us pray that the president be guided when he makes that decision, that fateful decision whether to sign or not to sign.
Pimentel also wants to hear more from the president about the Philippine government's deals with the United States.
What are these joint exercises which are happening, which have allowed the landing of American military aircraft here in the Philippines? So all of these things, we need transparency in government. So SONA is a report to the people of the president. So I hope that he will really be 100% or very transparent in his SONA.
President Marcos will deliver his second State of the Nation address on July 24th. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel wants government to be more cautious if it plans to file another case against China. See, former Solicitor General Francis Hardelesa earlier urged the Marcos administration to bring Beijing to court once again over its refusal to recognize the 2016 arbitral ruling. Hardelesa was part of the legal team of the Aquino administration that took China to The Hague back in 2013. But Pimentel warns any case against China should be airtight.
When we file something, then we are giving actually the other side a chance to bring up their planned original argument. If we get a negative result here, then although it may be on another matter, it can be spinned to mean that it is a reversal of the 2016 arbitral ruling. So if our position is that the 2016 arbitral ruling is already final and executory, so let us be careful in calling for a filing of anything which can be misconstrued or misinterpreted intentionally. We should pound on that ruling which is in our favor. Do not risk it anymore.
China still refusing to accept or recognize the 2016 arbitral win of the Philippines. That landmark victory invalidated Beijing's expansive claims in the South China Sea, with the International Tribunal at The Hague upholding Manila's sovereign rights over the West Philippine Sea. Beijing now claims the ruling has been widely questioned by the international community.
On the South China Sea arbitration case is consistent, clear, and firm. The Chinese Foreign Ministry issued a statement on this on July 12 of 2016, stating that the so-called award rendered by the arbitral tribunal is illegal and invalid. China's stance of not accepting or recognizing the award has received understanding and support from over 100 countries.
The statement comes after several countries expressed support for the Philippines Wednesday on the 7th anniversary of that ruling. Transport group Manibela will hold a three-day nationwide transport strike coinciding with President Marcos's second State of the Nation address. Jackie Manabat now joins us with details. Jack?
Carmina, Transport Group Manibela is planning to stage a transport strike on July 24, 25, and 26, coinciding with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s second State of the Nation address. The transport group said that the government promised to include them in the discussion of the controversial omnibus franchising guidelines, which aims to modernize the public utility vehicles and requiring the operators to consolidate for easier application of loans for the purchase of new modern units. Manibela is also the group that conducted a week-long transport strike in March, but was cut short when they were called at the Malacañang. One of the terms agreed was to move the deadline for consolidation on December 2023 instead of June. However, Manibela said that despite attempts to send a message to Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista for the revision and discussion of the omnibus franchising guidelines, Manibela's Mar Valbuena claimed that they were ignored. Valbuena also claimed that the government is giving priority to large corporations and LGUs in the rationalization of routes.
Hindi naman tayo sinabihan po na natutugunan yung mga hinaing ng ating mga kasamahan, hinaing namin sa Manibela. Nagpapadala po tayo ng mensahe kay Secretary Bautista, wala pong sagot. Palitan na po si Secretary Bautista. Wala na po ang ibang sasabihin, kundi mag-resign na siya.
Transport Group Hispan is also planning to march towards the office of the president on July 17. However, they clarified that the march is not a transport strike. They plan to submit a letter to the office of the president with a list of their demands, such as the revision of the omnibus franchising guidelines. They said that the provisions of the program will bury them in debt. The Department of Transportation is challenging Manibela's accusation that their claims are left unheard. The agency is asking Valbuena to provide concrete proof and evidence. In a statement, the Department of Transportation said they conducted a series of meetings on the issue of the Omnibus Franchising Guidelines or the CUV Modernization Program. The OTR also said that the transport groups are free to stage any form of protest. However, the agency will not be held hostage. To quote the OTR in their statement, they said, "The whole country and innocent commuters will not be blackmailed every time this group does not get what it wants." End of quote. Some transport groups have expressed that they will not be joining the transport strike. A transport cooperative in Taguig said that transport strikes do not directly affect the government, but would greatly affect the commuters. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Jackie Manabat. They're joining us on the line. Truckers also threatening to stage a protest, this time over the toll hike at the North Luzon Expressway. See, last June 15, NLEX implemented the toll adjustment, forcing motorists traveling within its open system to pay at least 7 pesos more. The Alliance of Concerned Truck Owners and Organizations slams that decision and calls for a suspension of the toll increase.
Hindi kasi justifiable yung ginawa nilang increase kasi kung kailan sobrang sama ng servisyo nila, saka sila nag-increase ng toll. Uh-oh. So hindi commensurate ito yung binabayad ng mga tao doon sa servisyo yung binibigay nila.
The Appeals Chamber of the International Criminal Court set to hand down its decision on the Philippine government's plea against the resumption of its probe on the Duterte administration's drug war. The court will deliver its ruling on July 18. The ICC halted its probe on the bloody drug war in November 2021 at the request of the Duterte administration. Earlier this year, the pretrial chamber authorized the resumption of the probe, saying it was not convinced the Philippine government is making a genuine effort to conduct investigations. In March, the Marcos administration appealed to suspend the ruling and reverse the decision, insisting the ICC has no jurisdiction over the Philippines.